Joining us now, Kevin Mandia, the CEO of FireEye. Kevin, much to discuss and great to have you with us. I want to do a deep dive on what's going on here, but my first question is simple. Are we making it worse by paying these ransoms?
Well, you know, first off, nobody wants to pay a ransom. Start with that one. And that's usually the default beginning for all of these. But I think the calculus is different by industry because you have to look at the risk. And that's why you just said they're targeting hospitals. Because if you're a ransomware actor and you break into healthcare and you impact the devices that maintain human life, the risk calculus is going to be very different in regards to payment of ransomware than if you run another type of business. So the bottom line, the ransomware actors are targeting specific industries and public companies, recognizing that the likelihood of being paid is far higher in those industries.
And that's the key. They're going for critical infrastructure, things like hospitals, like food supply, like fuel supplies, for example. Mm-hmm. Are you therefore in favor of banning these payments? Take away the incentive to do another attack?
You know, it's tough, and you'd love to have a simple answer. And really, when you go to the extreme, obviously, Julia, if you pay ransoms, you're propagating the challenge. But the reality is there are probably risk decisions that are made where if you're a hospital and ransomware hits you, you may make the decision it's better to pay now and de-risk our patients than the risk of moving your patients out of the hospital. So I think a ban is far more complicated once you get below the surface and you really look at the issues. I mean, I've talked to the CEOs who have to make these decisions, Julia. It's not simple. Nobody wants to pay it. Nobody wants to propagate the problem, but they also don't want to hurt human life.
Yeah, I mean, they've said in the last couple of days, we've heard from them, that it's the toughest decision they've ever had to make in a leadership position. And I couldn't agree more with that. So we can't be on the defensive. We can't and shouldn't be having to make these decisions. We should be on the offensive, Kevin. Let's explain why this is happening and why we're seeing this huge acceleration, particularly in the last year and a half. Is it about the fact that we're introducing vulnerabilities with greater digitization, working from home, or is it just that the software that allows hackers to mount these attacks is more available?
Well, I think the biggest reason, Julia, these keep happening is we're only playing defense. The best defense in the world gives up touchdowns. That'll be my football analogy for today. And that's all we're doing. If you can commit a crime from 10,000 miles away, in a safe harbor with no risk or repercussions, you're just going to keep taking shots, period, indefinitely, and sooner or later, they're going to work. If we don't find a way to impose risk or repercussions to those launching the ransomware attacks, over time, every company's going to have to deal with one.
Define repercussions then in this case, because what we've seen, particularly in the last couple of cases, we believe is that these attacks aren't being done from the United States. They're being done from other countries, countries where the leadership has pretty little incentive, quite frankly, to do anything about these hack attacks or target the hackers themselves. So how do we create repercussions?
Well, very simply, we're an international community. The internet's connected all of us. It's only, you know, it's been around since the 1980s. We've got to figure out how we're going to work globally on this. If you want to be part of the global economy, the bottom line is I think there's rules you're going to have to follow, and you cannot condone bad actors that are stealing potentially billions of dollars from other nations. So I think the answer is not just technological, Julia. Okay. It's also going to be diplomacy, potential economic levers that you can pull, but it's going to take nations banding together to figure out what are we going to do about this, because most people will think it has crossed the line of toleration. Status quo is no longer tolerable.
Yeah, there has to be economic and financial consequences as well. Talk about the impact of digital currencies, because what we have heard in recent weeks is that these payments aren't being demanded in US dollars. Digital currencies are being given as an option, and that's how they're being paid.
Absolutely, Julia. That's been the progression. It used to be if you're an attacker and you wanted to monetize your hacking capabilities, you'd hack into computers and steal credit card data when you'd purchase things, or you'd hack in, change applications so you could fraudulently order things. Now you break in and you can deploy ransomware, or you can steal documents and extort the fact that you're going to publicly release private documents. Digital currencies are basically anonymous currencies. So you add the anonymity of digital currency And now you can commit a total crime from 10,000 miles away from the victim, be anonymous in cyberspace during your attack, and be anonymous in cyberspace collecting the payment via digital currencies. So there's no question digital currency in its form today, how it's managed today, does enable cybercrime.
I mean, in the Colonial Pipeline case, and we can come back around to that, the payment was recovered for various reasons. There has to be a protocol here. And I think what we also heard in the past week was that, you know, these CEOs, they weren't quite sure what to do. They weren't sure of the protocols. Fortunately, in both cases, they called the FBI and were like, guys, this is what's going on. What do we have to do? It's the very basics here in terms of companies. And obviously, you advise many of them on how to tackle these things, that we need a protocol. This is what you do. This is who you call. Sure. This is how the payment's made in order to try and be able to trace the money and recapture it quickly if we can.
Well, Julia, you're describing the age-old problem. With every technological advancement, criminals figure out a way to use it, and a lot of times they're faster at innovating on how to use it to make money and enable their enterprise than the good guys. So there's no question we have to do a little catch-up now and look at digital currency and figure out how do we manage it in a way that's meaningful and prevents all the fraud that's currently occurring with the enabling digital currencies.
Okay, Kevin, upshot, are we winning this war or losing this war? And does it just mean more spending required, both from the private sector and the public?
Well, I think it's an ongoing effort. You know, you don't win the fight on crime overnight. Quite frankly, you're just always fighting it every single day, Julia. So just because you read the headlines, we're certainly getting better. We're certainly looking at ways for nations to respond more cohesively. And that's been the dialogue in the United States. How do we respond not just as individual companies, but as a nation to the cyber threat? So we're going to get better at this.
And an international community, to your earlier point, too. We're all in it together.